Turn with me to Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 25 through 32. And I was going to again tonight to, because we're, this month's theme is love, and I'll tell you, I'm just not sure what you can preach about without being attacked. Last month I preached about money, and boy, did I stir up the most natural devil in talking about money. But that's okay. I was prepared for that, and that's part of my responsibility. And guess what? If I'm going to stay the pastor of this church, I'm going to talk about it again. And so I was attacked by that. I don't mean attack, probably is a strong word, but I was, you know what I'm talking about. And the folks that aren't, they get on you. And so the folks that are, they love you. And so now we're preaching about love. And man, I thought, woo, love, I ought to get some rest this month. Well, I thought preaching about love, they ought to lay off me for a little bit. But the past few services I've come in, I won't name names. But, these guys, they'll say, man, you got to let up on this love stuff. You're killing me. Come on, guys, chickens, now say something. Where are you now? And one said, man, my wife, she has, the past 2 weeks been horrible around my house. Well, just go back and listen to the sermons and do what's been preached and you'll be all right. Yeah. Ooh, we better move along. I'll get in trouble even more. And so tonight, I understand I don't have a tie on. I did it on purpose. And some will be mad because he didn't wear a tie. We weren't upset. But listen, the Holy Ghost can come without a tie, with a tie, no tie. Tonight, I'm going to talk to you. I'm going to teach you tonight. Some will be upset about it. I know. But listen, what you don't know, and what about, let me ask you a question. I don't have on a tie, and neither do some others. But let me ask you tonight, what about Chris, a fireman that came in at the end of the service today and fell on this altar after you were gone home or already standing in line at the buffet? What about Chris that came to me that almost died in a motorcycle wreck, came to me after the service and said, Pastor, would it be okay if during the praise and worship service I came down to the altar to worship God because I just want to be thankful to what he has done for my life? Would you, he said, would you be offended if during the worship, sir? I said, no. So listen, what about all of those things? What about the young man that came in the last 6 minutes of the service today, just off the street, smelled like he rolled out of an ashtray and asked us to pray for him and said he'd be back tonight and he's here and we want to focus on what the pastor's wearing? What about salvation? What about what happened around these altars today? What about those kind of things? We want to get stuck on, whoo, the anointing can't come because he don't have on a tie. You better get your head out from under a rock. Now, tonight we're going to talk about communication. Did I just clearly explain, or is there anything hidden? You need to know. I'm not being rebellious, defiant, or anything else. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 25. Tonight, I want to talk to you about, and I didn't make a worksheet because sometimes when you have a worksheet, you get so caught up in trying to fill in the blanks of the worksheet, you miss what's going on. So I hope in some way tonight I'll say something that is noteworthy, and you may already be so mad at me you don't care about writing. But I hope tonight to say something under the Holy Ghost that will help you in your marriage and will help you in your family tonight. And I'm going to talk to you about communication in the family. Tonight, not necessarily communication between the husband and the wife, but I will do that, but also with our children. And so there's a little saying in my house that we've started. I preached on this. Sometimes, you know, when you mess up and preach about something, then you have to live it out. And I preached on not long ago, a few years back, I think, in fact, that I preached on, I called it, did you hear me or were you just listening? And so now that has become a running statement in our home. Did you hear me or were you just listening? And so tonight I want to talk to you about communication. It is one of the great things that is missing in our homes, in our marriages, period today. Our communication, our form of communication now is on... Wow, They are doing good, Ference. They don't have them out. They had to dig for it. This is our form of communication now. This is the way we talk. And boy, it's sad that now we can't have a face to, was this mine or yours? Oh, it's yours. We can't have anymore a face-to-face conversation. We quit jobs by texting. We quit the church by texting. So tonight I want to talk to you about communication. If you'll give me a few minutes to set this up for you, I'll get to Ephesians chapter 4. So hold on just there for a minute. 25 through verse 32. We have families and marriages that were married not by the justice of peace, but by the secretary of war. We have marriages today that were married not by the justice of peace, but by the secretary of war. Everywhere you see people are fighting. Fight, 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 fight. Most family problems can be related back to the issue of communication or the lack of. And we have a failure to communicate. We identify the symptoms and not the problem. I said we identify the symptoms and not the problem. We are very quick to say, you did this, you did this. No, you did this. No, you did this. No, you did this. And we become right fighters. What do you mean, Pastor, by right fighters? What I mean by right fighters is we fight till one of us finally says, okay, you're right. We quit and we save all of those things till later. Am I talking to y'all? I'm going to try to teach you. You say, we didn't have this problem when we were dating. We didn't go through this when we were dating. That's right. That's because you were lying. You were saying what was necessary. You were doing what was necessary, and you were trying to impress them, and because you were lying, so now here you are in reality. Oh, I love flowers. She loves flowers. I love flowers. Yes, do you love flowers? Yes, I love flowers. We're going to the Pizza Hut. Pizza, where do we go? Pizza parlor. We're going to the pizza parlor, and I'm trying to date her, and we're having conversations. You like flowers? Oh, I love flowers. You like going to the movies? Ooh, I love the movies. I'll tell you, I just love the movies. You ain't seen one in years, but yeah, I just love the movies. You like long walks on the beach? Oh, I couldn't get over enough walking. I just love walking. You like, I love to hold hands. Let's hold hands. And now I do, you do, and we all do, and you don't do any of those things anymore. Boy, the back, you're really quiet way back there. Maybe I should have had everybody come down here. And so we didn't do that when we were dating. That's because we were doing everything we could to get what we were after. And so the concern in Ephesians chapter 4, I'll be there in just a second, is overcoming conflict and communication. And that's what we want to talk about tonight. Proverbs chapter 13, verse 17 says, in the Message translation, says it this way, irresponsible talk makes a real mess of things, but a reliable reporter is a healing presence. In Solomon's day, a king had to rely on messengers for information about his country. The messages that were sent in Solomon's day, they could not be evangelistically stretched out. If there were 40, there were 40. There weren't 75. It could not be, the story could not be stretched. The messenger had to tell the king exactly what the king needed to hear. The messengers had to be trustworthy. Inaccurate information could lead to bloodshed. Reliable information is still vital today. If the message received is different from the message sent, then marriages, businesses, and relationships will all break down. Let me say that again. Reliable information is still vital. It's still vital in communication. If the message received is different from the message sent, it's amazing how things I say grow by Monday afternoon. I say wonderful things that I didn't ever even say. I'm like, wow. And then I say a whole bunch of things by Monday afternoon that I did not say. Come on. We could start a rumor right here with Alina. And by the time it got all the way around and it finished over here with these guys on the front, it would be a completely different story than what I told Alina. Woo, because you got to put your twist on it and you got to put your angle on. He said, now he said, I wasn't supposed to tell, but he said, now she said, I wasn't supposed to tell. You know, it was a red car, but it was really a Corvette when it was really a Pinto. Woo, but by the time it gets over here, so reliable information. I'm talking about communication in your home and in your family. I'm going to make a point with you in a minute. It is important to choose your words well and to avoid reacting until you clearly understand what the other person means. Understand what they are saying. I, at times over the years, and I have had to learn because I am very hard-headed and stubborn. Well, that's a good time for you. And you know what I was going to say. That's probably why you didn't say anything, because I would have said, and so are. That was pretty funny to you guys. It is very important to understand what's being said. A few years ago, and I won't call the name of the ministry, you'll be able to figure it out. I think I mentioned it a while back. But a few years ago in Houston, we did a food ministry where the box of food, it was $65 worth of food that we sold for $25. $65 worth of food, good food. It wasn't, and I'm not talking about any other, but it was good. It was Kraft, it was Campbell's, it was good. It was $65 worth of food that we sold for $25. We were trying to help family. We were trying, and it was great food, box full of food, but the people could not understand it. What's your angle? There is no angle. It's $65 worth of food for $25. But yeah, I understand, but what's behind this? There's nothing behind it. It's $65 worth of food for $25. But yeah, why are you selling it so cheap? Because we're buying so much. So guess what? That ministry went because people could not understand. They were wanting to read so much into it. How? Why are you able to do? Did you steal it? Did you get it off the black? Come on, tell me something dirty about $65 for $25. Tell me what's wrong here. It's nothing wrong. It's... So we got so tired of talking about it, we just X'd it out. You've got to understand what is being said. Ephesians chapter 4, let's go there now, verse 25 through 32. The Bible said, listen to the words, therefore putting away lying, let each one of you speak truth with his neighbor, for we are members of one another. Verse 26, be angry and do not sin. It's possible. Do not let the sun go down on your wrath, nor give place to the devil. Let him who stole steal no longer, but rather let him labor working with his hands what is good, that he may have something to give him who has need. Verse 29, let no corrupt word proceed out of your mouth, but what is good for the necessary edification, that it may impart grace to the hearers. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Let all bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor, and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. Verse 32, and be kind to one another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, even as God in Christ forgave you. That entire scripture is about communication. We're going to break it down in just a second for you. This passage is speaking of unity in the body of Christ, unity in the family, and unity in the marriage. How many of you know the enemy loves nothing more than to bring division? Come on, say amen. He loves nothing more than to divide. That is his job. If he can divide and conquer, come on, if he can destroy you at home, if he can divide your marriage, if he can split your home, I'm preaching to you, if he can divide the home, then he can divide the church. Because if it don't work there, it's not going to work here. This is not the church. You are the church. This is just a beautiful building that we have to come to tonight to, as a tool to worship and reach more souls and reach more souls. You are the church. So if he can divide you at home, then he divides right here. If he can bring divorce and he can bring all the problems in your house, guess what? Because we bring that here. Come on, I'm going to try to teach you tonight. We bring that here, right? If you're struggling at home, when you leave your home, you just don't leave it at home. Come hang around with me for a week. I'll show you. We bring it all. We take it all everywhere we go. So if the enemy can divide at home, and listen, the scripture is talking about unity. And I don't have time to preach on this tonight. I've got it set up to do this in March when I start preaching to you about where we are in time and what's going on prophetically and what's going on in the world. But you, do you know that even the Bible says in the last days that God will cause the children, that they're going to leave home, that they're going to turn against their parents? Did you read that, or did I just, I found that in the my version of the Bible. Says in the last days that even the home, they're going to divide, and kids will turn against their parents. That breaks my heart to think. It's already happening. It's already happening. Unity. And let me say here, and I'm going to try not to preach to you. I want to teach you tonight. Just slow down, because I hope I'm trying to help you here. And listen to me tonight. If we can't get it right here, then how do we ever expect them out there to come in here? Well, that's... If we fight, argue, fuss, and fight in here, why do they ever want to get off their bar stool? Why do they ever... Because, listen, the gangs, the addictions, all of those things right now are keeping them further and further away. Because I'm not sure over the years we've had it right in here. Come on, we divide over things like ties. We divide over things like music. We divide over things like paint. Come on, if you could really think about it, please don't raise your hand or say amen. Blanche. If you really think about if you think back over most of the arguments in your life, wouldn't you say they're really just ignorant, petty stuff? Wouldn't you say, really, what a waste of time? Wouldn't you really say, man, boy, I'm so dumb. If I had an opportunity to go back to that point in time, I wouldn't have said that. I wouldn't have done that. I wouldn't have gone that far. Listen, I had to do it in my own family just a few weeks ago. And I had to apologize to my entire family to say, I'm sorry, I blew it. Yeah, your pastor blew it. I blew it. But guess what? So have you. And I reached a point to say, listen, I'm sorry. I love each one of you. This passage that I just read to you from Ephesians speaks about unity in the body of Christ. Unity in the... Man, I'll tell you, think about it tonight. If this church family could get on the same page, I'm telling you, we could blow this city off the map. It's the truth. 120 did it. If we could get on the same page in this church, think of that. I'm telling you, we would take Van Buren, Arkansas by storm. We'd knock Fort Smith off their feet. You got to see it before you see it, or you'll never see it. So, I want us to look at a few rules tonight. Here's where I hope, maybe if you're taking notes, or you will, that this is where we'll start. I want to look at four points tonight, four rules actually, that Ephesians points out in Ephesians chapter 4 that I just read to you, four rules that it points out. Number one is the rule of speaking the truth. Ephesians chapter 4 verse 25 says, therefore put away all lying. Well, Pastor, it's just a white lie. Listen to me. Don't be deceived. There is no white lie, gray lie, purple lie, blue lie, any lie. A lie is a lie, and a lie is sin, period. Come on. There is no, and I wish as a church we could, body of Christ, that we could get over this. There is no gray area. I had a gentleman last week that doesn't go to this church. In fact, I'm not sure he goes at all. And asked me, he said, Pastor, just could you tell me where in the gray area I can live and still make it to heaven? I said, sir, I hate to inform you right now. There is no gray area with God. Either you're on his side or you are against him. And either way, either you go to heaven or you go to hell. There is no gray area. There is no white lie, small lie, big lie. Come on. And the Bible said there, put away lying. Let each of you speak truth with his neighbor, for we are members of one another. Can you grasp that? And it just came to me standing here this evening, so I don't have time to preach it, but as I just read it, it came to me. It said, let each one of you speak truth with his neighbor, for we are all members for we are all members of one another. So that means if we are members of one another, we are all a body, and if one lies, it affects all the rest of us. Wow. Wow, let me read it to you again. Put away all lying. Let each one of you speak truth with his neighbor, for we are all members of one another. Ask Achan whether or not he affected the entire group. Because of one man's sins, many people suffer. Achan could not. Go back and read it in your Bible. Achan couldn't follow the rules of God. Maybe he thought he was too good. Maybe he thought he was more anointed. Maybe he thought he was smarter. Maybe he thought he'd been in the church for so long that it didn't apply to him anymore. I don't know what Achan's thinking was, but whatever he did, what he did affected everybody else. And God said, go get him and his family and everybody that has any DNA connected to Achan, and bring them before you and tell them today. And so you know the story. There was not a trace of Achan's family's DNA left. God wiped out an entire generation for one man's lies. You know why he did that? Why I believe he did that? Because he didn't want a trace of lying, of thievery to continue on in the church from that day forward. So therefore he wiped away an entire... Boy, what if he did that tonight? Would there be enough church to make a church? Come on. I'm just giving you something to think about, because the stuff that applies then applies now. I just wonder, would there be enough church to make a church? The word lying means that which is false. It is untruthfulness, deception, misrepresentation, exaggeration. Lying is an attempt to deceive another. If you're taking notes, write this down. A lie does at least two things. Number one, a lie misrepresents the truth. It camouflages and hides the truth. Listen to me, there's two things that I despise. I don't like using the word hate. I don't like that word. But so there's two things I despise most. I despise a liar and a thief. Come on, if I've got it and you'll come ask me and I can, I'll loan it to you. Do I need to preach about what the Bible says about loaning? If you've got it to loan, anybody? Come on, if I've got it, you don't have to steal it from me. You don't have to break the windows out of my truck. You don't have to break into my house. You don't have to do all those things. I'll give it to you. If I've got it, I'll loan it to you. Listen, I'm out of the deal of borrowing just about anymore, because every time I borrow your stuff, it tears up. Isn't that right? Anybody ever notice that? Just me. Man, I borrow something I'm really in need of. I'm thinking, boy, I could go buy that, but man, it's just way, costing me way too much. I know Jerry's got one. I'll go get it. I'll borrow it, man, and I'm going to return it back, and praise God, it's going to go back just like it came. All right now. Never does. I told you about the trailer blew up all the tires on the side of the interstate one time, but I didn't tell you about the tractor I borrowed. I borrowed a tractor to... Bush Hog. Another guy and I had a tractor there in Houston, and I could borrow his. We used all the time. We used it on each other's places, but he happened to be using it, so I went and borrowed another one. And so I got that tractor and I get out to my place and I'm going to bush hog. I'm going to clean my place. And I get out there and, man, I unload that tractor. And when I got in, it started it up. And, man, it fired up just like that. I get it off the trailer and turn around to start out into the pasture. And when I did, white smoke just went to boiling out of that. Exhaust pipe. And I'm thinking, what in the world is wrong with this tractor? I just unloaded it. Come on, I ain't even turned the bush hog on yet. And so white smoke is just boiling out of a diesel tractor. Brother Dennis, you know probably what I'm about to say. And I mean that white smoke is just bellowing like a chimney. That diesel isn't running nowhere near like it ought to. And I stopped it. I called the guy that I got it from. I said, hey, man, something's wrong with your tractor. He said, no, when it left here, it was in fine shape. Woo, and when somebody says that, I just immediately break out and a sweat comes on top of my head because I can just see thousands of dollars, right? Diesel motor not cheap to work on. I said, I just got it off this trailer. I hadn't even turned on the bush hog and it's blowing white smoke. He said, did you put gas in it or diesel? I said, I didn't put any in it. You said it was full when I got it from you. So I went over. I had shut it off, went over and opened the lid and leaned over to smell in that gas tank, and it was just as straight unleaded as it possibly could be in a diesel motor. I thought, praise God, this one is not on me this time. That's a good feeling, isn't it? I called him back. I said, hey, dude, this is your problem, not my problem. Now, can I just tell you right here, and you've said this 1,000 times, but I want to say it in all the ears that are listening tonight by here and by way of live stream. The truth may not be always what you want to tell, but it ought to be the first thing that you always tell. Come on, truth is hard, and it's hard to face it. Come on, it's hard to face it. It's a whole lot easier to lie. But what I found out, when you tell one, you got to tell another one to cover that one. Then you got to tell another to cover those two. Come on. Boy, all the parents ought to be saying amen. So speak the truth. A lie does two things. It misrepresents the truth. The person lied to does not know the truth. Therefore, he has to act or live a lie. If the lie is serious enough, it can be very dangerous and damaging. For example, in Acts chapter 5, verse 1 through 11, you know the story of Ananias and Sapphira. It can be very, very damaging. The Bible said, now a man named Ananias, together with his wife, Sapphira, also sold a piece of property with his wife's full knowledge. He kept back part of the money for himself, but brought the rest and put it at the apostles' feet. Now, you know the story. They were supposed to be giving everything, but Ananias thought, man, I can just hide. I can just keep a little bit of this. I'll just keep a little bit of this. And because of his dishonesty, listen, because of just a little bit of his dishonesty, it not only cost him his life, but it also cost him his wife's life. The Bible said, the scripture there, and I'm not going to read for the sake of time, but said, how can you lie to the Holy Ghost? Secondly, lie deceives a person. It leads a person astray. Listen, a person deceives to get what he wants, to cover up or to hide something or to cause hurt or harm. The perfect example of that is in the Garden of Eden. It was with Eve in the garden. Scripture gives one strong reason for believers to speak only truth. They are members of one another. Every believer is a member of a great body of people which God is building, the body of Christ. That is the church. William Barclay has an excellent description of this point when he said, we can only live in safety because of the senses and the nerves that pass through the message system of the brain. He said, in fact, these senses and nerves took to passing false messages to the brain. For instance, if they told the brain that something was cool or cold when touchable, when in fact it was burning hot, life would very soon come to an end. A body can only function accurately and healthily, if you will, when each part of it passes true messages to the brain and to other parts. If then we are all bound into the body of Christ, that body can only function when we speak the truth, and all deception impairs the working of the body of Christ. Ask Achan. He held back part of what God said to do, and it affected the entire body of Christ. I preached, if you remember, you may not, not long ago, I preached a sermon on don't go messing with my blessing. And that's what Achan did. Achan went messing with Israel's blessing, and he paid with his life for it. When I, let me start to get where I need to be. When I, as the leader of my home, I am a liar or I am a thief or I am only partially living and doing what I'm supposed to be doing, do you think it's only going to affect Britt Brooks? Think about that. The Bible said that the sins of the father would be passed to the children from generation to generation thereof. The open doors of sin that are in my life are doors of sin that are open in my children's life. And I cannot afford them in this day's time. Number two, the second rule you see in Ephesians chapter 4 is be angry and sin not. Boy, here we go. Ephesians chapter 4 verse 26 through 27 said, be angry and do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your wrath, nor give place to the devil. Do not give place to the devil. Listen, there are times when anger is called for, but we are to guard against sinning and become angry. The Bible said, be angry and sin not. There are times when you're gonna get angry. Let me say this, I'll come back. Anger can be a good thing and anger can be a bad thing. It can be like dynamite. Dynamite tears things down. It explodes roads that may be closed. It causes rivers that have been stopped up to flow once again, that have been blocked by trash. Dynamite can rip something apart in milliseconds. Anger causes us to either react, lash out at, and hurt others, or else it motivates us to right wrongs and correct injustices. Well, you didn't get that. Anger causes us to either react, to lash out, and to hurt others, or else it can motivate us to right wrongs and correct injustices. If you look across our world, and then I'm going to bring it to your front door. If you look across our world today, anger, people are boiling. Come on, say amen. They don't even know what they're mad about. Most folks are mad just because everybody else is mad about it. I was watching the news the other night and they were interviewing all these folks. And they were just asking simple questions, just very simple questions. Do you know the countries that they are trying to levy the travel bans against? That was just the question. You know the country. Can you tell me the countries? Da-da-da. Some of them could. Some of them missed a whole bunch of them. One guy pops up and he says, none of the countries that they're trying to get rid of are a terrorist threat to us. And the guy said, did you know that Iran is the number one terrorist school and training place, training country in the world? And the guy said, uh-uh. Well, it didn't take a rocket scientist to figure out what this answer was going to be from this guy. Are you listening to what I'm telling you? Come on, are y'all living under a rock anywhere or not? But people are mad. Did you see the report of the kid that hit the ground screaming and yelling when the election results came out? I'm thinking, man, you need a whipping. You did not get enough whippings when you were at home. And if you'll get up, I'm going to give you, come on, anybody think about stuff like that? I know y'all are sanctified and you're angels and you're, pray for your pastor, please. I'm way behind you. I know. I see the anointing and the halo over the top of your head. I got you. But I'm just not there yet. Pray that I'll quickly get there. I thought when I saw that boy, I thought I ought to whip you and whip your mama and your daddy. Whining. And boy, that's the generation. that's going to vote on your kids if Jesus tarries. So anger can be a good thing. It can be a bad thing. It can be like dynamite. And so today what ought to happen, and I know it's not what happening, is that anger, if you don't like it, then do something about it. Protesting is not tearing a building down, setting a city on fire. Voicing your opinion in your home, sir, is not going in and cutting them to shreds. Voicing your opinion, ma'am, and talking your opinion and being angry is not going home and shutting the door on your husband for 2 weeks. It is to be used in the right way. So let me hopefully help us tonight. There is wrong anger, or what may be called unjustified or selfish anger. Let's look at it just for a second. Number one, there is an anger that can be an unjustified or selfish anger. There is an anger that broods that is selfish. Come on now, listen, I want to tell you tonight that a lot of times when you're preaching something, you have to live it first. A lot of things I preach are things I've lived or I am already going through. Come on. And I believe that that happens for me to effectively be able to convey it to you. You need to know that I know what I'm talking about because I've been there and done that. Now listen, don't get me wrong there. Don't get messed up. I don't believe you have to be a good sinner to be a good pastor. Did y'all get that? Gotta get that. I don't believe you have to be a hater to be a good pastor. I don't believe that you have to do that. But listen, it does help a congregation when you know that your pastor can connect to where you're living today. Come on. I put my pants on just like you do. I have struggles just like you do. I didn't float in here tonight. Come on. I didn't float in here this morning. I needed this morning just like you needed this morning. Come on. We argue at the Brooks house. Woo, we have some good ones. I'm talking about we've got some on record. Some of y'all just can't get past it, can you? You just can't. If Jesus came and said he argued, y'all would still just sit there. Really? Boy, we've had some wonderful ones at our home. And I have won every one of them. Come on, I thought you guys said y'all was going to help me tonight. Where y'all at? Go back to the first point. Y'all are sorry. Look here, you come sit over here. And you come sit by your wife. Boy, a lot of help y'all are. I got your back, Pastor. Yeah. I grew up in a very angry home. My dad was in the military for 44 years. My dad was gone. I had three sisters at home, my mother. And I'm just telling you, and they may be watching tonight, but I'm telling you the truth tonight. I'm telling you, we argued, fussed, and fought. We yelled. That's all I ever knew in my home. That's all I ever heard. That's all I ever heard. They would fight about the curling iron. They'd fight about the hair dryer. They'd fight about who was going to wear what, whose clothes they was going to wear. Those were just the starting. That was yet but a light affliction. Anybody know what I'm talking about? I'm trying to be funny a little bit with this because it's hard to swallow what I'm going to tell you here in a second. I grew up in an angry home. We yelled. That's all we did. And as I look back on it today, I regret a lot of it, but I don't make excuse for it. But I was a kid. I didn't know any better. And we just grew up in a really volatile situation. And so you couple that with my dad not being there, and I struggled for years with what did I do, what we do that's bad enough to cause you to leave us and leave us in this situation. All we ever heard was what a monster he was and how bad he was. And listen, I've learned over the years, there's always two sides to the story. I love my mother. We grew up in a volatile situation. And I grew up a very angry kid. And trying to figure out, you know, all these other kids, they got their dad. He shows up their football practice. You know, my dad missed football. He missed my first truck. He missed my first girlfriend. He missed baseball. He missed basketball practices when I played. He missed all of that. And so I grew up in being a very angry person. And listen, here's what happened. And I'm being vulnerable with you tonight. I know, and I know how this can work, but that's okay. I hope I'll help at least one person. But what happened, if Jerry did something to me that was even close or relatively close to what my family had done to me, that was a block in the wall against Jerry. And if Gary did something now that's even, that he rejected me or didn't, then that's a block in the wall against him. And Cody, and that's a block in the wall against him, till eventually I've walled myself off from everybody. Am I helping any? And so over the years, I have had to, and listen, I have had to have the Lord to help me with not being an angry person. And I believe the Lord has helped me with a lot of things, but listen, I can get with the best. Mm-hmm. Well, let's just have a contest, Blanche. You come up here. Let's just start. There is an anger that broods and that is selfish. It harbors malice. It will not forget. It lingers. It broods. It will take revenge. And sometimes it even actively seeks revenge. Yes, it does. There is an anger that holds contempt. It despises, it ridicules, it arrogantly exalts itself and calls another person empty and useless. This is an anger that is full of malice. It despises and scorns. It arises from pride, from a spirit of pride from within. Such feelings or anger can walk over and trample a person. It says whatever ill comes upon a person that is deserving of that. Come on, I'm talking about an anger tonight. And I'm sure I'm not the only one that has lived in this house. I'm sure I'm not the only one that this happens to. I'm talking about an anger that you, when you will say things, I'll have to say, and I'm telling you stuff today that I probably will regret later on, but our first year of marriage, mine and her first year of marriage, was terrible because I was trying to learn how to keep my mouth in check. I was learning how to hold the reins on my mouth. And I'll tell you, at times I still haven't. Well, as you can tell. There's an anger that can come out of your mouth that'll cut somebody in half. That tears somebody to shreds. That'll tear somebody to pieces. And the fact is that normally we project it to those that love us and care about us the most. That one that's been there when you were sick. That one that held your head while you were throwing up in the commode. That one, come on, that rocked you and changed your dirty diaper when you were screaming in the middle of the night and your no good sorry daddy would never get up to help to do anything. And they rocked you and they're the one that will shred in half. We shred the church. We shred with our mouth what God wants to do. Because we didn't get our way. I didn't. That didn't go like I wanted. Well, this ain't Burger King. You don't get it your way. Butt went over like a lead balloon.
Oh, but I thought I was, you know, I've been.
No. Guess what? I don't get a whole lot of things my way. We get mad and we spew. Listen, I'd love to preach on this, but I'm afraid it'd scare you so bad that I just won't do it. So if you'll help me, I'll illustrate it. Come here, Hunter. I've been wanting to preach a sermon. Turn around. I've been wanting to preach a sermon for years. Several years back when we went to Christian Temple, it was bad. We had, they were writing letters. Board members were writing letters on us. They were writing letters to the congregation, talking about us. And I mean, it was really, really bad. Really bad time. And none of what they were writing and wanting to do was true. So I was the associate pastor, and I went into Brother Norton's office one day. I said, I got a sermon for this church. He said, oh, really? He said, go ahead and tell me, what's the sermon? I said, well, I'm going to preach tonight. I was preaching that night. I said, I'm going to preach tonight on the pink tornado. And he just kind of leaned back in his chair. And, you know, when he would want to talk to you, when he'd look over the top of his glasses at you, he'd say, well, you better tell me your talking points. I said, I'll tell you what, a tornado has absolutely no respect. A tornado will tear down a $3,000 building as well as it'll tear down a $3 million building. It don't care about the architecture. It don't care how much money it costs, who worked on it. It don't care about any of that. And a tornado will just come through and rip it to shreds. And I said, so I'll tell you what I'm going to do, Pastor. I said, I got an ammo box, a big ammo box at home, and I'm going down into the Hispanic community at the meat market, and I'm going to buy me a big old cow tongue, and I'm going to put it in that ammo box tonight. And I said, I'm going to preach on the pink tornado. I said, everybody, I said, you fast and pray up a word. We fast and pray up music. We're going to teach and do different series of sermon. And with the tongue, with the pink tornado, it'll rip apart in 1 second what took a year to fast up and pray up, what took God to put into your heart. And people will shred it in half because they don't like it and they don't think they was talking to you. And I said, middle way, at this time I'm standing up in his office. I'm preaching it to him. I said, I'm going to jerk that box open and I'm going to rip that tongue out right there in the middle of the service. And he said, Britt, that's exactly what you're not going to do. I said, but Pastor, can't you imagine? Won't that be a great effect to rip that big old cow tongue out and say, here you are right here. He said, oh yeah. And he said, on the next morning, you'll be looking for a job somewhere else. Some of you are sitting here looking at me, and this is what tears your marriage apart. This is what's destroyed churches, and it's what tried to destroy this church. But in the name of Jesus, it's not going to take place. I cancel every negative word, every negative spell, every negative spirit, every negative thing that's been spoken over Van Buren First Assembly. I cancel every legal right, every name. We shall. I said we shall. We'll go forward with you, or we'll go forward without you. But we're going forward. Woo. I said, we're moving forward. I said, they can talk about us. They cannot like it. But this is the will of God. And we... Pastor in the Spanish church one day, witch walks in the back door and sets on the risers in the back. She has all of her candles. She's got all of her stuff. In the middle of my preaching, I'm just wailing away. You know how I do. I saw her come in. I knew exactly what she was when she walked in the back door. She set all her candles up back there on the risers while I was preaching. She goes to lighting all of her stuff. She gets all her stuff set up. And I'll tell you, the more she lit, the more I got lit. Did y'all know your pastor lit? You better say amen. Amen. Say it again. Amen. Y'all didn't say it. Amen. I'm coming to preach down there Wednesday night, so you better say amen. Boy, it's just not good. She had light stuff. I see her setting all that stuff up, and I'm telling you, the harder I preach, I saw her doing it. And she got to going with her little spells and stuff while I was preaching. The scripture came across my mind, a curse of ill effect has of no refute. Meaning there's nothing she can do because the anointing's on my life. There's nothing she can do in this service. She can burn every candle in Houston, Texas. Are you listening to what I'm telling you? And you can sit back and you can talk about this church and you can talk about this pastor and you can talk about this vision. But if God's on it and the anointing of God, you can burn every candle in the state of Arkansas and you'll never, you'll never stop the will of God. All you're doing is spewing poison. You might as well be a witch yourself. In fact, I think you are. Because when you're in rebellion against the will of God, that is as the sin of witchcraft, which makes you a... Ooh, Pastor, you just called me a witch. No, I'm not anybody in here. It's them people watching online I call. I was talking about them. And those that are secretly watching online. Are we communicating effectively here? There's an anger that curses. It seeks to destroy a person and their reputation morally, intellectually, and spiritually. Romans chapter 12 verse 18 says, if it be possible, as much as lieth in you, live peaceably with all men. If it's not possible, then Proverbs chapter 22 verse 10 in the Message translation says it this way, kick out the troublemakers and things will quiet down. You need to break from that bickering and griping spirit among you. Ooh, I like that first one. Can I read that again? I felt the anointing on that one. It said, kick out the troublemakers and things will quiet down. Did y'all hear that? It said, kick out. There's none here. There's none here. There's no troublemakers here. We're not going to have it. Said, well, Pastor, I'm not sure you could put me out anyway. Did y'all know Blanche is my bodyguard? Oh, we'll get you out. Oh, yeah. And we got about some half-saved deacons that would just like an opportunity. Just kidding. Erase that from the video. I was just kidding. What would have happened a long time ago if we'd have put out the troublemakers? Now listen, I'm not telling you to go home and put your family out. Don't go home and say, Pastor said, you got to go. Come on, look at your neighbor and say, that's not what he said. Now turn it back on because I need to go on record right here. That's not, because I don't need all y'all in my house or in my yard. Too often, hurt feelings exist between those who are supposed to be the closest. Husband and wife, parent and child, neighbor and friend, employer and employee. Hurt feelings exist between those who are supposed to be the closest. We are supposed to be the people that have this together. Now listen. I understand we are supposed to be the people. We are supposed to be the people that have the answer. We do have the answer. And listen, I know that trials and troubles and difficulties and intense arguments are going to come. Intense fellowship are going to come to your home. But we are supposed to keep it together. The Lord is clear about the matter. We must never allow anger to take a hold of us without just cause. Let me give you this if you're taking notes. This is good here. Three elements that it takes to make a fire. And three elements when anger sets off, if you'll let me set this up for you, three things that it takes for you to blow your fuse, if you will. Three things that it takes. It takes, number one, the fire is anger. Number one thing that it takes is air, or a distorted perspective, which equals a twisted idea of things. For a fire to be set off, number one, it takes air, which is distorted perspective or a twisted idea of things. We make a lot of choices and decisions, and we mouth a lot of things before we have all of the facts. We have a distorted perspective. We have a distorted view. We don't have all of the facts together, so therefore we form a twisted idea of things. So that's the first thing. That's the first step, and I'm fixing to go off here in just a second. The second one is fuel. The fuel could be grudges, which equals a deep feeling of deep resentment or deep-seated resentment. Fuel or grudges, because we hold, we take score, or we keep score when we are fighting. We don't normally fight about the future. We always fight about yesterday. If you hadn't have done this, if you would have done that years ago, if you would have said this, if you would have been there, come on, if you would have done that. And so what's coming out, what we are spewing, is things that we are holding on to. We've never took, come on, is that not true? There's nothing you can fight about the future because you don't know what's going to happen. Can you imagine fighting about the future? Well, I bet you're going to do this. Well, I bet you're going to say this. All right, I bet this is going to happen. You can't fight about that. So what you hold on to is words and things that were done and said to you years ago. Some of you are still fighting about things that happened when you were a teenager. Some of you are still arguing. And man, come on, you just love to pull that one thing out. Oh, I'm coming to your front door. That one thing, man, you know it's the right button to punch. Just this group over here. You know the right thing to say to set her off. You act just like your mama. Ooh, that's a good one. Say amen. Some of you said it today, didn't you? You act just like your... She's watching, ain't she? She is. Oof. Thanksgiving won't be good this year. Ooh, but I don't go for the turkey no how. When we, our first year of marriage, my punchline was, you are Brenda made over. Boy, that'd get it going. Come on, when the fight starts to settle down, I don't like it. We're going to finish this. I'd pull that one out. Boy, then it's bonfire right all over again. Are y'all listening to me? Y'all do stuff like that? I know Daniel does. Just looking at him, I know he does it. I know you do. You got a bank full, don't you? Oh, yeah. 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 Don't lie. I just talked about lying. She is a good, godly woman. You're the one that messed her up. Woo, I felt the anointing all over that. Mm-mm-mm. That was just, I'm sorry, it was too easy. You made that too easy. Woo, I'd go to my punchline that first year, and I knew that was a good one. And the next one would be, when that one started to calm down, and I wasn't done, I said, well, I'm going to send you right back down there with them. You can just load your stuff. And you can get on down the road and go right back down there with them. So guess what? One night she did. Come over here. Come on. Where's the grannies? Because I know the grannies. take care of you. Well, that should have been done a long time ago around here. They should have done that a long time ago. So we hold grudges. And we still fight about yesterday. Absolutely wasting time. The third thing in letting the anger go and building that anger up is a heat source. In order to make a fire, there has to be air, there has to be fuel, and there has to be a heat source. And that heat source is related to offensive incidents or an attack against you. You can't live, listen to me, you can't live, I'm going to help you here, you can't live in the house with someone else and not get angry. Come on, I should have set somebody free. Deliverance, somebody should have just jumped up and shook your weave off the top of your head. Oh, I'm sorry, we're all white people. That could have been, only Blanche could have done that. I'm sorry. She don't wear one, though. Some of you should have jumped up and shouted. Because you can't live in the house with somebody else and everything go well every day. Come on, there are two different opinions, two different thoughts, two different ways of doing. Come on, she's emotional, I'm not. I ain't looking at y'all anymore. When you have, for example, in our home, when you have someone that is a strong D, a choleric, a driven personality, and that kind, and you have someone that is melancholy, which I wish I were like her in a lot of days, in a lot of ways, I wish I were like her, but there's something in me that just doesn't let it happen. Right? Yesterday, we're working out in the yard, and all their tongues are dragging the ground. They've been cutting weeds and cutting limbs, and I walked back there. They showed me the job. They've done a wonderful job, and until I showed up, and I said, "That's not enough. There's more here to do." Y'all don't do that. So when you live in a home, that's why you need to be here on Wednesday nights, to find out about another love language. When you have somebody that's a strong D or is a choleric and is a driven kind of person that, listen, I could not have slept last night if I'd left the weeds on that wall. That's the kind of stuff that keeps me up. If the for the pulpit's not over there and it's supposed to be over here, that's the kind of stuff that keeps me up at night. I think, man, we got first thing in the morning, we got to move that. We got to do that. But when you have somebody that lives on the other end of that, and that's not a bad thing. I'm not pointing her out. I love my wife, and I'm not pointing her out. She's just a different personality than I am. And when you put those together forever in a house, and you're trying to raise little ones that have your mixed personalities. Woo! Jesus, take the wheel. Isn't that right? God, help us all. You can't live in a house and not get angry. But you don't have to let it cause you to sin. Number three, I'll move quick. I know I've taken up a lot of time. Number three, let me move fast. Number three is stop stealing. Pastor, I'm not stealing. Hold on. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 28, let him who stole steal no longer, but rather let him labor, working with his hands what is good, that he may have something to give him who has need of. The word steal in this scripture means to cheat or to take wrongfully from another person to keep held back. Listen to me, adults. You cannot use to get your point across. What'd he say? Fill in the blank. Come the first Wednesday night of next month, I'm gonna fill them all in for you. You cannot use what God intended for you as a couple. You understand what I'm talking about in your intimacy. You cannot use that as a weapon against your spouse. Well, we'll just see how you like this. Don't you feel the uncomfortable spirit in the room? But it's the truth. And if we don't talk about it here, who's going to talk to us about it out there? And when we use that as a weapon against our spouse, the Bible says that you have sinned because you have withheld from your spouse. And you're using that which God created as a weapon to try to get your point across. So therefore, I am stealing. Boy, it's quiet now. A person steals from a family member or friend by keeping back or holding back. Holding back what? Keeping what is not needed for one's own needs. Keeping what is not needed for one's own needs, such as food or love or caring. They hold it back. Keeping back what is desperately needed by others, we steal, which is love. Keeping back the knowledge and gifts and blessings of wisdom God gave you for the welfare of your family in a world filled with so many that are not as privileged as you and your family are. And we hold that back. Come on, listen. Listen to me tonight. We have a huge gap in the generations. I praise God for the college-age kids that are here, or young people that are in this church tonight, but look around. Where are they at? Where's the rest of them? Well, they're at school. Where are the 22s to 33s? Look around. Come on, look around. I'm asking you, turn your head, turn your head. They're not here. They're not here. And they're absent in most churches. In the previous church that I was pastoring in, we had a group of families that railed on this subject. Where are they at? How come you can't get them here? Why can't you grow this church with that age group? Why can't you do that? Why can't you? And I said, they're some of the toughest people to reach because their mamas and daddies never taught them about the things of God. They never shared with them about sex. They never talked to them about the Spirit of God. They never shared with them about any of those kinds of things. So they're gone. What do you want me to do? And so one guy said, I'll tell you what I'll do. He said, I'll give you $75,000 for you to go hire an employee to fill this spot, and that'll get them here. I said, give me your money. But I'm telling you, sir, it's not going to work. Because it didn't start in the church. It started in the home. And I can't fix in the church what's originated in the home. Boy, that's good preaching. Here's the money, he said, gave me $75,000. We went out and hired what we thought was the best college and whatever guy, guru, and he's going to bring people. And guess how many he brought? None. Zero. What I'm telling you about, listen to me, church, tonight, and I don't have time. I'm out of time already. I can't fix, and this staff can't fix, what has to happen in your home. I can preach about it, I can sweat about it, I can ruin this suit over it and never do any good, but it has to start at home. And one of my greatest fears and panics, after all the statistics that I gave you about the finances of this church, and because that group is absent in this church, and I told you in the next 10 to 15 years, if that continues, this church will no longer be in existence.
That's right.
Because they're not here.
That's right.
I know that falls on a lot of deaf ears, but I hope you hear me what I'm telling you tonight. That is not just the statistics of this church, it's the statistics of this community that we live in. The median age of this community is 33 to 35 years old. And if they're not in the church today, what on God's earth do you think is going to bring them to the church in 10 to 15 years? We have a lot of work to do. I said, we have a lot of work to do. You may call it whatever you wish. Well, he doesn't deserve it. She doesn't deserve it. They don't this, they don't that. You may call it whatever you wish, but when you withhold from your partner or you withhold from your family, what you are doing is you are stealing from them. Number four. I have a few more. I'll have to hurry real fast. Number four is stop the worthless talk. I didn't get to preach this morning, so I'm making up a little time here. Stop the worthless talk. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 29 says, let no corrupt word proceed out of your mouth, but that which is good for necessary edification, that it may impart grace to the hearers. Do you think that I need to constantly be browbeating my kids and tell them, you're just not good enough. You need to try harder. Boy, you're just not smart enough. You need to try harder. Boy, you're not. How many of you know that doesn't work over the long haul? What works over the long haul is, man, you are awesome. You are absolutely beautiful. You're doing a wonderful, wonderful job. What can I do to help you? You ever talk bad to your children or to your spouse? The Bible says, be angry and sin not. Romans chapter 3, verse 13 says, their throats are open graves, and their tongues practice deceit. The poison of vipers is on their lips. Proverbs 25, verse 11 said, a word aptly spoken is like apples of gold in settings of silver. Proverbs chapter 15, verse 23 said, a man finds joy in giving an apt reply. How good is a timely word? Listen to me, only a word that is good for building up instead of tearing down is what you and I need to be speaking. There's enough negativity in this world today for a gazillion years being spoken right now. I said it this morning, and I ought to be, I guess, more up on things. I don't know, but I'm just behooved at times at the things people are saying today. How ignorant. The only people that should know your problems are the people that can help you. Otherwise, you ought to keep things to yourself with worthless talk. How many churches tonight, their doors are closed because people couldn't? How many churches tonight are non-existent? How many church people, man, they used to be on fire. Serve, rock the babies, do the visitation, drive the bus, sing in the choir. They were here. But because somebody couldn't keep their mouth closed. And I understand we ought to all be more mature. There are times things are said about me. I laugh about it. Lady here a while back, she had lots of things to say. I called her and talked to her, and I told her, I said, I wish I'd have known when you was talking about me, because I'd have come over and give you some ammunition to keep going. There's a lot of things I just let roll right off my back. Because I consider the source. Hasn't happened here. Just to put you on notification, what I'll do if it does. I've gotten letters under my office door after service. You know, those that they're gutless enough they can't sign, but they want to tell you all of what you ought to be doing and all that. You know what that does to me? Tear it up and throw it in the trash. Meaningless words if you can't come tell me. How many marriages are destroyed tonight? I'm talking about in the church. I'm not talking about the sinner. I'm not talking about the guy sitting on the bar stool tonight. I'm talking about us. And possibly some even sitting in this room tonight. And I know you look good and you've got it together, but man, when you get on home, you go to your room and she goes to hers. Things that are on the rocks, and it happens because we can't keep our mouths in check. Number five, and I'm done here, is don't grieve the Holy Spirit. There are at least four ways to grieve the Holy Spirit. Let me give them to you real quick right here. The Holy Spirit is grieved when believers allow impure things to penetrate their life or thoughts. Romans chapter 8, you go home and read it. Another way to grieve the Holy Spirit is when believers behave immorally. Romans chapter 8, verse 12 through 13. Therefore, brothers, we have an obligation, but it is not to the sinful nature to live according to it. But if you live according to the sinful nature, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the misdeeds of the body, you will live. Another way we grieve the Holy Spirit is when believers act unjustly. And finally tonight, another way that we grieve the Holy Spirit is when believers participate in anything contrary to the nature of the Holy Spirit. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 32, I read it to you in the beginning, says, and be kind to one another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, even as Christ forgave you. Come on, I already said it. If you continue to live together, there's going to be disagreements. For those of you that are not married and you're headed down that road to get married, God bless you, I pray for you. And you better be praying for the right one. Young people, don't be chasing all of them just because they're pretty. Because one day they'll wake up and Ooh, somebody said, pretty is only skin deep, but ugly is to the bone. Ain't no ugly people here. None of us. But I'm telling you, don't be so shallow as to marry them for what they look like. Don't be so shallow to marry them for how much money you think they've got. Because if they got it and you get it, you're going to spend all of it. Money doesn't buy happiness. And if this world continues on as I believe that it is going to, there's going to be a whole bunch of us that don't have very much of it. What are you going to do when you don't have that money? What are you going to do? Have you noticed, have you been watching the news this week, what's going on in Venezuela? Venezuela now is the number one country in the world seeking asylum into the United States because they are starving to death. Saturday, the news report come out. I don't know if y'all watched this or not. I saw it Saturday. We're in Venezuela right now. Their government is so corrupt and they don't have money and things are horrible that now they are hunting dogs to eat. They are killing the flamingos in the parks just to eat, to live. And tonight, you and I will go home and we'll argue over whatever it is. Is it really that important? The Bible said there in the scriptures, it said to live right morally and to forgive each other. Here's how we're going to do this altar service. I'm going to have two questions for you. Here's how I felt like the Lord said to me before I walked out here of how to end this. If your spouse is here, I want you to go to him right now. Come on, if you're on the platform, just play some music or something. Come on, if your spouse is here, I want you to go to him. Most of you are probably all with them. Boy, some of you guys that got on me about last week, you're really going to get on me about this. But I believe.